In this video, you'll learn about building choice experiments in SurveyEngine. We'll go through each of the major classes of choice experiments from unlabeled, opt-out, to labeled experiments. In a separate video, we'll show you how to do status quo and pivot experiments, but as they involve a little bit of data processing, we'll leave them for now. So we'll first create a skeleton survey and leave a few pages blank for the experiment scenarios once we've done our experiment. Going straight to the experiment builder, let's create an experiment and give it a name. We'll start with an unlabeled route choice experiment. In this experiment, we'll focus on transport route choice to show you how the different forms of choice experiments might be used. First, some orientation on this screen. The experiment editor has four tabs up the top here. The first one, which we're looking at, is the specification, and this is where all the alternatives, attributes, and their levels are input. This is sometimes known as the X matrix. We can also create multiple responses with this settings button here. Then we have a tab devoted to the layout of the experiment. The next tab is for experimental design, and finally an advanced tab, which allows you to directly edit the XML, but we won't be going to that today. So with an unlabeled experiment, all alternatives have the same attribute and levels. Let's enter them now. We'll go with the familiar route choice attributes we've already used for travel by car, being travel time, 20 minutes, 40 minutes, and 1 hour, level of congestion, from no congestion to frequent congestion, and the cost of a toll, being none, $2, $5, and $10. For each attribute, there is a generic tick box. This tells the software that this attribute is generic and should use the same levels in all alternatives. We'll leave this as it is, but come back to it when we do opt-out and labeled experiments. Under settings here, we can also change the text for the choice question or add multiple choice questions, but let's leave it as it is. Going to the layout screen, we can see what it looks like with the standard default layout. We can see what it will look like with random levels in by clicking this button here. This is useful to see how levels of different length might work with the rest of the layout. You can also see what it looks like on small devices, which is a consideration that shouldn't be overlooked with more than half of all access on the web by small devices. On the right here are options for controlling the layout, ranging from simple to complex. Firstly, structure. You have either a table layout or a more freeform box layout, which has its own options. We'll start with the table layout for the first run. Going through these checkbox options, alternative headers, unchecking hides the column labels, inner row borders, row padding, alternating colors, and finally, the choice labels. Putting everything back, we then have the attribute names, where to place them, either left, inline, or hidden, which is pretty useful if you've got many alternatives. Then widths. This allows you to give more space to the alternatives or to the attributes, depending on the content. And finally, the positioning of the choice question. Alternatively, you can use the box layout. This gives a bit more fine-grained control over positioning and formatting. And when we get to best, worst, and multiple alternatives, it gives a better user experience. Finally, if you have the expertise, you can specify CSS rules, which are formatting instructions. Now, this is a little bit more advanced, but there's a lot of support online. So, for example, if we want to increase the size of the attributes, we might enter this in a CSS. And for really fine grain control, you can directly edit the HTML template and move the attributes around. You just need to make sure that you keep the attribute and alternative names intact. And of course, we can reset everything back to its default. And then we have the experimental design. We'll skim over this a little, as experimental design deserves its own video. The easiest way to generate a design is to just click orthogonal. This will produce an orthogonal design with some default properties. For unlabelled designs, only the first alternative is orthogonal. The subsequent alternatives are offset from the first. So some care needs to be taken with more than two alternatives, because if the number of levels is less than the alternatives, it's possible for alternatives to be identical. You should read up on sequential and simultaneous designs to understand why this is so. The second point about these orthogonal designs is that it uses a nearest fit algorithm such that the next largest design is used and the additional levels are padded, meaning it's possible to get unbalanced designs. An alternative is to use Engine to generate designs with this button, but we'll cover that in another video. Let's now go back and create an opt-out experiment. We'll use the same experiment, but make a copy. Making our experiment opt-out is simply a matter of creating a third alternative. We'll name it neither and set all the levels to empty. We do this by unchecking the generic option and removing all levels. Now, we don't need to regenerate the design, but it's good practice to do so when you've changed your experiment specification. Checking the layout, there's not much more to do. Now we'll do a labelled experiment, reusing as many of the attributes as we can. As you will have learnt in the other videos, labelled alternatives introduce another piece of information to the respondent. The alternative often has additional meaning and therefore utility. It also allows us to make the attributes specific to the alternative. In this example, we'll use particular roadways as the alternatives. Let's use three. The first one being suburban backstreets, the second, a main road, and number three, the autobahn. We'll also use different ranges for time and also remove toll for backstreets and main road, making the experiment more plausible. Looking at the layout, we see that the toll doesn't change now for backstreets and main road, and the ranges are much more realistic. Let's generate a design for this. And finally, we can now put any or all of these experiments into our survey by simply selecting experiment and choosing the experiment we want to show to people. And we can just place them on the page wherever we want and mix them with text and even other questions. Previewing the survey, we can now see what it looks like in the page. You can put multiple scenarios, even from other experiments, in the same page. And while this is probably not a good idea for complex experiments, it may be a good idea if, for example, one experiment is an information condition followed by a context-specific experiment. And finally, you can also specify the design row, either explicitly as a number or as a computed expression. This is useful for custom blocking schemes or when specific rows need to be displayed, for example, in dominance or consistency tests. And we'll cover blocking in a separate video. Thanks for watching.